takes me back to my childhood. And one of my favorite TV shows, The Twilight Zone. It wasn't scary in the same sense of traditional horror shows. It was eerie and mysterious and made you think about things that you had not thought about before. You never knew, or you never know, I should say, how these things might influence you. All these things we take in as children like that. But I'd like to think that this TV series encouraged me to adopt the principles that I now affirm as a Unitarian Universalist. And indeed, the creator, producer, and writer of most of the episodes of the series was Unitarian Rod Serling. Today I'm going to share with you a little about his life and some lessons we can learn from his life. Then other sermons that I'm going to have in this series, I call it my spring series, it does feel like spring, but for spring semester, we'll use some of the classic Twilight Zone shows to explore the values that he sought to nurture through his marvelous creativity and through his marvelous imagination. I'm pulling from several sources, including biographies from Wikipedia, the UUA webpage, the UU Heritage Project, also an interview with his wife that was published in the Twilight Zone magazine, and a sermon by Rod Green. Rodman Edward Serling was born in Syracuse, New York, to Samuel and Esther Serlings. The Serling, a Reformed Jewish family, then moved in 1926 to Binghamton, New York, where Rod would spend the remainder of his childhood. The Serling family was involved in the Binghamton Jewish community, a community held together by ethnic underpinnings more than religious ties. Like many of the local Jewish community, Serling's family infrequently attended synagogue except during high holy days. His dad, Sam Serling, he was vice president of the Reformed Temple for a while. He told Rod and his older brother Rock this. He said, "I'm not a good Jew, but I think I'm a good person. If you want to be very religious, that's up to you. My own philosophy is this. I take people for what they are, not where they go to pray." Sam enrolled his sons in the Sunday school at the local Jewish community center, where director Isidore Freelander and his wife, philosophical humanists, were spiritual mentors to many of the youth there. At high school, where he edited the newspaper, Serling experienced anti-Jewish discrimination when he was blackballed from Theta Sigma fraternity in high school. In an interview in 1972, he said of this incident, "It was the first time in my life that I became aware of religious difference." Now, this is a picture of him as a young man. I think this picture was taken when he was 17. While he was in high school, he also wrote scathing editorials in his high school newspaper. He was also a good debater, known for his sharp sense of humor while he was debating. And he loved to box. By his senior year, of course, World War II was in full swing, and Rod enlisted in the Army, serving with the elite airborne division in the Pacific with the 511th Parachute Infantry Regiment, and was involved with the invasion of the Philippines. He witnessed the horrors and the brutality of war and saw many of his best friends killed. He was awarded the Purple Heart for a severe shrapnel wound to the knee. The war also took a permanent mental toll from Rod. He would always suffer from flashbacks, nightmares, and insomnia for the rest of his life. When discharged from the Army in 1946, he was, quote, "bitter about everything and at loose ends." Fortunately, for him and many others, he had the GI Bill. So he enrolled at Antioch College in Yellow Springs, Ohio. Now, in those days, Antioch was one of those schools with loose social rules and a unique work-study curriculum. Greg tells me they always called it, in Ohio, the hippie school. You know, even before there were hippies, you know. It was a hippie school. But it was a stimulating and liberal intellectual environment, perhaps just what Serling needed after the war. And he felt, this is a quote from him, the need to write, a kind of compulsion to get some of my thoughts down. Serling shared that he was also inspired by the words of Unitarian educator Horace Mann. There's a statue of him on that campus with these words. It says, "Be ashamed to die until you have won some victory for humanity. Be ashamed to die until you have won some victory for humanity." It was at Antioch that he met and fell in love with Carol Kramer. In her interview with the Twilight Zone magazine, she describes their beginning this way. She says, "Rod was one of that large group of returning veterans right after the Second World War. It was the fall of 46. I was a freshman. I was 17, and Rod was 21. We were married 2 years later at the end of our second year. We lived in surplus trailers brought up from somewhere in Texas, I think. There was no running water. There was kerosene heat and cooking. We had a communal place where everybody washed. The college put the trailers up. There must have been 20 or 25 of them, but nobody felt sorry for themselves. We were lucky to get them." She describes Serling's post-war decisions with these words. Rob didn't really know where he was going at first. He'd been accepted in Antioch while he was in high school, but the war intervened. He enlisted without graduating and ended up in the paratroopers, which is another story. When he came back after the war, he took a college work-study job at a rehabilitation hospital near Chicago because he had been wounded. He was wounded in the wrist and knee, but the knee was the serious one. He went through school with additional compensation because of the disability. He could have had disability all his life because the knee was always going out on him. He'd be going down the stairs, and all of a sudden it would snap. I'd hear a bong, 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 and then I'd think, oh, God, he's falling down the steps again. But he lived with it. Actually, his major that first year was physical education. After that, he began to get involved in theater and later broadcasting. Now, Carol was a Unitarian, and she convinced Rod that he should become one as well. They were active in Unitarian churches wherever they were living. After college, he did some freelance work on radio shows and in the fledgling TV industry in Cincinnati, Ohio, and he was writing, acting, and producing these. Carol laughs as she remembered him doing the Geritol ads with a southern accent. I could have done those. He was told by his agent that to really make it, he'd need to move close to New York and get some attention from publishers and producers there. So in 1954, he and Carol and their little daughter Jody moved to Connecticut, where he continued to freelance writing for anyone in New York who would buy his material. Their second daughter, Anne, was born in 1955, just as his career was about to take off. And that year, there was this nationwide show called the Kraft Television Theater. How many of you old enough remember Kraft Television Theater? All right. Greg and I watched one. You can see those old shows on YouTube. And they even had the old advertisers with them making, Greg and I watched them take that Kraft Philadelphia cream cheese and you put some sugar in it and you put instant coffee in it. And that makes your icing for your coffee cake. Pretty good. So the Kraft Television Theater, and it broadcast a script he wrote called Patterns. Patterns was the name of that script. Now Patterns is a story of a corrupt corporate boss who manipulates an unwitting up-and-coming executive to push out another employee that the older man fears. It was a stinging indictment of American business practices, critically acclaimed, and it earned Rod Serling his first of several Emmy Awards. And from that time on, he never had to freelance again. Then, the move to California. It was described by the UU Heritage Project with these words. By the late 1950s, the days of live television, New York teleplay, that's how the craft one was done. It was live. Folks in the East saw it live, and then the others in the West saw it recorded. By the days of 1950s, the days of live New York teleplay were over, and the television industry had to move to Hollywood, where there was more money, equipment, and talent. In 1957, the Serlings moved to Pacific Palisades, California. Serling believed, quote, that of all the media, TV lends itself most beautifully to presenting a controversy. He found that with television, he could take part of a problem and, using a small number of people, get my point across. However, Serling quickly realized that to get a point across often meant creating scripts that contained controversial messages and dialogues. Corporate sponsors, on the other hand, had no desire to have their producers match with messages that might be deemed offensive. And Rod Green noted that any races to race or poverty or things that might question the idealized version of the American way of life were strictly taboo. This was the era of McCarthyism, after all, a time of witch hunts against suspected communists. It was professional suicide to be associated with concepts like free expression or civil rights. Any critique of the government or the excesses of capitalism, any commentary that might be perceived as, quote, un-American. Well, in 1959, Serling expressed his frustration with this. He said, "I think it is criminal that we are not permitted to make dramatic note of social evils that exist, of controversial themes as they are inherent in our society." But he couldn't get his stuff done. I mean, it was just, editors would totally, he tried to do something on the Emmett Till thing in Mississippi. By the time it actually got produced, it was way up in New England with all different people, not right about black and white. It was, you know, just totally redone. Because of the hostile creative environment, Serling began to see the advantages of writing science fiction and fantasy. He learned that advertisers would routinely approve stories, including controversial situations, if they took place on fictional worlds, or in fictional worlds. And so out of this realization came
you unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound, a dimension of sight, a dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
He also wrote many film scripts as well as the Twilight Zone, including, and I didn't realize this until I was preparing this message, he was the writer of the original Planet of the Apes script. It was based loosely on a French novel, but Rod Serling is the one. And of course, that is another film where a lot of values and moral things are in there, but it's on another planet and another situation, you know. It was in California that Rod and Carol joined the UU Community Church of Santa Monica. And this is a picture of that church. Carol, who is now 91, is still a member there. An article in UU World shares remembrances from their pastor about Rod Serling's time there. This was their pastor. He said, "Theologically speaking, Rod was what we call a naturalistic humanist, and that was the underlying philosophy of my pulpit," says the Reverend Ernest Pipes. He's now their minister emeritus. He said, "Racial issues, class, power, you find all of these in his writings. And he found reinforcement for his viewpoints in his congregation." Pipes remembers Serling as generous in both money and time, and he often led lucrative fundraising, showing and discussing his teleplays. Wouldn't that be good for us to have something like that here? He just needed some Rod Serling. So he did those things out at that church. At one church picnic, Hikes and Serling collided, going for a fly ball. And this is what Pipes said about it. I said, I hope I didn't hurt your riding arm. And he was generous enough to reply, Ernie, I hope I didn't hurt yours. Although their primary home was in California, the Serlings spent part of each summer at Cayuga Lake in upstate New York. Carol shares about this special place. She says, well, the summer place had been in my family forever. Rod and I spent our honeymoon there and hardly ever missed a summer. We missed two summers, the summers the girls were born, but otherwise we always went up for July and August, from Ohio originally, then from Connecticut, then later from California. That was always a very important part of our lives, to spend as much time as possible up there. In addition to his work with television and movies, Rod did some teaching at Ithaca and at Antioch. You see what's in his hand there? It's not a pointer. Carol reported that he hated to fail the students and was an easy grader. If you remember the old Twilight Zone series, you remember his narrations usually showed him with a cigarette in his hand. His work pace and his 4-pack-a-day cigarette habit alarmed even his 1960s colleagues. In 1975, at the age of 50, while pushing a rototiller in his garden, he had a heart attack. He was told he would need open heart surgery, and he died during the surgery. 50. Just 50 years old. When I first read that, I thought, wow, that was young. But then my son just died at 46, and many die even younger. We just don't know, do we? Rod died young, but he tried to make a difference while he was alive, as we all should do. His wife Carol stated, Rod cared very deeply about things and felt that it was our responsibility to do something about it. I don't know how he'd feel about the current scene now, but he'd probably be on some soapbox somewhere. Of course, through the wonderful world of film, we still have many of Rod's lessons with us. You can go to YouTube and see them. And that is what I hope to use in this series as a launching resource to call on all of us to aspire to, as Carol said, do something about it. We may not be able to write an award-winning television drama or write a movie script like Planet of Apes, like Rod Serling did. We can sure write a letter to the editor. We can feed hungry folks. We can work for peace and justice. And we can share love with others, as my son Fred did for so many. May it be so.